Okay. Hi. So I forced to show you this slide. I'm not sure what it's all about, but your time is now. Okay. I remove it and then they add it. And so this is the presentation. It's about all about TRex. It's the first time to present TRex in DevNet. So I'm really excited. My first time in Berlin. It's my first time showing that to this audience, and I didn't expect that it will be full at 9 o'clock in the morning. So really thank you to come so early. And you know, before I start, how many of you are familiar with TRex already? Heard about? No one. So it's fresh. Okay, TRex is a relatively new traffic generator. We open source it. It's from Cisco. We open source it a year ago, and by now many are using that. And there are thousands of traffic generators. And now, in this presentation, I will explain why Intel, Mellanox, Verizon, Imperva are contributing and starting to use that. Okay, and Cisco itself. So this is the presentation. It's more about why, the story about that, and what it can do for you. It's not marketing. I'm from engineering and created this from engineering. By the way, there was a presentation about TRex in DPDK for developers. This is not that. It's more for overview about the capability of that. Okay? So TRex started as stateful, and now it's stateless too. I will explain the model of the traffic. What is the problem? I will do a short demo. I verified that the demo is working before. So the Wi-Fi is great. So I will connect to my network in Israel, and I will show that. So I will start with stateful and why we did that. OK? OK. The current situation, in our situation, was deep packet inspection. I'm from a team that create AVC. Anyone familiar with AVC for Cisco? AVC is a complex feature. It's a stateful feature. And actually, it's common to all features that inspect traffic that is complex. In those features, packet is not just get into the system, create a few lookups, and then get out. And you can usually, using hardware or ASIC, you can get to line rate in 64 bytes. They are complex features because in those cases, you have a lot of lookup. You are first classify the packet to a flow, and then classify it to a socket, and then for specific packets, go into the packet to a DPI and do some sort of DPI or analytics. And there is a lot of engines. So not every packet is the same. There are packets that you can cost like milliseconds and packets that are nothing, just one lookup and get out. Now, to get meaningful performance number, you must test in realistic scenario, right? In production. The best is to put it in production, get your customer check it for you, and get the result, right? Not test it in the lab. But if you want to test it in the lab, you must create a realistic scenario. So, and to get meaningful. In our case, so what is the problem? So there was a lot of feature like that. The problem starts when you are trying to merge scale and functionality. Usually you are doing functionality in low speed and scale with meaningless traffic like UDP or something. If you want to merge them and to create scale and functionality together, you find very weird behavioral, and this is the reason we created that. The reason is that one of our customers, we tested it in 5 gig. And in ASR, if you know anyone work with ASR 1K, service router of Cisco? Okay, in the service router, the same source code can work from ridiculous speed like 10 megabit per second to 400 gig. Okay? So our issue is the same code working on 400 gig. How do we test it in 400 gig? Because the issue is totally different. There is multi-core, a lot of contention, and specific scenario created, in our case, latency. And we didn't know that because we tested it in 5 gig and we extrapolated. Okay, so everything started, this project started from a customer case that opened a bug and say, hey, we are using, we are seeing NBAR working in 30% CPU utilization, and we have from time to time 1 millisecond latency. But in our case, in our lab, we tested in 5 gig. We didn't get you to the rate that this guy did. So we needed a scale. Spirent can scale only to 5 gig, and it's super expensive even in 5 gig. Even after we bought Spirent, we didn't have the flexibility and scalability to change the way the traffic is generated, because it wasn't realistic enough for us. Okay? The back-to-back packet, there was packets that are back-to-back. There is no delay. There was no simulation of the latency of the network that, in our case, created a lot of contention. So in our implication was that we couldn't verify this customer bug when it couldn't solve it. Okay? We had a complex feature. We didn't have the way to test it. And it's super expensive. This is the situation. This is the problem that I'm trying to explain now. How did we solve it? OK, anyone has a question? No. OK, the solution was, luckily, the hardware today for SDN and NFV and networking is really cheap and fast. So if you can take a server with like Mellanox or Intel NICs, you can get to a rate of 400 gig easily. The question is, how do you write the software? And 2 years ago, when I started this thing, DPDK was just a zip. There was from Intel, there was a zip from Intel. I took it. It was great. And then we wrote the software. We started to write a software that simulates our situation. And it could scale to 200 gig. We can create a realistic scenario for our test, for our feature. We found, we recreate the user, this customer bug. Not only that we found the bug and solve it with a new infrastructure, we found that there are more features that has the same bug. Okay? Because there was no way to test, to combine scale and functionality until this T-Rex. And I put it in a wiki in Cisco, and some other team started to use it and found the issue, and we created a virtual team. So this was the foundation, and after that, we open source. Okay? So the main feature of the stateless is creating, you can create a model. I will show you what is the model of the traffic. And once you create a model, you can amplify it to 200, 400 gig. Mellanox is, I think Mellanox is pushing it to 400 gig today with really, millions of flows and millions of client and server. This is something that you cannot do with standard Linux, with iPerf. There is nothing that can do something like that, OK? Nothing that I'm aware with the scale and capability. And it's everything is open. You can just take a server, standard NIC that we support. We have a list of NIC. Not all the DPDK NIC are supported. And it's really easy to deploy. I will show a demo how to deploy it. It's just wget. Extract a zip file. I think anyone can extract a zip file and run it. That's it. OK? So just to the model. As I said, any aspect of the traffic is important for performance for complex feature. Every aspect. For how many packets in a flow, what is the back-to-back, what is the inter-packet gap between the packet, everything. What is the layer 7 data? Because the DPI, the regex, is doing different things once you have different layer 7. And we created the YAML, a model of a YAML file. YAML is like a JSON. Everyone knows what is the YAML. YAML is like JSON file. Is something that you represent object. And you can represent the model of the traffic. So for example, how many clients you have, what is the distribution, how many pools of clients, what is the, how many servers? For example, for DNS, you can say, hey, I have only 1, 2, 3 DNS servers in my premises. But for HTTP, there are millions, right? Everyone go to Google and so forth. So you can create realistic scenario of the traffic. And then once you created that, you can amplify that. You can amplify it to very high rate. I'm not going to get into this, but this is the model of the software. It's not about that. It's multi-core, so you can, once you have more core, you can scale it. It's linearly scaled. Okay, it's flow-based, it's not packet-based, so everything has a flow and template. And there is a, the model of client and servers. You can define clients, client pool, server pool. For every server, you can define VLAN, and et cetera. And there is a automation and benchmark automation and GUI. Okay. This is the really basic block of stateful. There is a flow. Okay. In this case, this is a flow of four packets. The green is the first in flow. We call it fifth. Okay, so you can define what is the connection per second. What is the rate between the packets of the first packet? And you can define what is the inter-packet gap, or you can take it from the pickup file that you captured, and then the tool can know how to play with it. This is a formula. The most important formula is this one. How many concurrent flow, how many active flow you will have in the system? So the number of active flow is actually the duration of the flow multiplied by the number of connection per second. Okay? Mellanox, for example, take it to 10 million flows. I don't know why, because it's not realistic, but you can play with it. This is the okay, just you know, to give you an example. So back to the story. Once we had that, we created a profile that matched the customer. We scale it, and we found the issue. Okay. Now I will give some hello world example for stateful. So you will understand. This is really a hello world. What I'm defining, it's a range of 255 clients, 255 servers that I will simulate, and one pickup file, DNS pickup file that you cannot see, but there is two packets in DNS, request and response. Okay? And let's see what happened. Okay, and another thing, I can define the connection per second. One flow per second in that case. Don't worry, we can amplify it to 10 gigabit. But it just defined the relation between the capture and the flows. Let's see what happens if I will play that. There is a simulator that you can run this profile and see what happened. And you can see that the first flow is going to 60.0.0.1 to 48 in this direction. And then there is the response after that. This is the first flow. This is flows. This is time. So you can see there is one flow every 1 second. And the inter-packet gap between the request and response is the inter-packet gap from the pickup file itself. You can override. There is a lot of argument that you can put in the YAML. The nice thing about YAML and JSON that you can add more and more features and you don't break the backward compatibility. Any question about that? Okay, another example is that we have two template. Now the HTTP is 2 and DNS is 10. So I expect to see 10 flows of DNS in 1 second and only 2 of HTTP. So I'll just add that. I don't really need to change that, the client pool and the server pool. Let's see what happened. You can see the HTTP, actually there are 50 packets, but you can see only 10 because they are one after another because the time scale is 1 second. But you can see that there are 2 HTTP and 10 DNS. Okay, and the distribution, that the tool will distribute correctly the client and the servers. Now this is interesting. This is the bug that we had. And this is some realistic scenario. We took a local sorry. We took realistic profile, and actually in Cisco before TRex there was a benchmark how to test a stateful feature. Okay, there was a profile already. So what we did, we replicate that 1-to-1, and then with TRex and Spirent you can generate the same traffic. The only difference is that in T-Rex now we can take this 5 gig and amplify it with one UCS to 200 gig, but with 3K instead of $100K. Okay, you see the difference? You see what we did? And in this case, you see there is a lot of HTTP, HTTPS, browsing, RTP, video, audio, email, Oracle. And it's, you know, from layer 7 perspective, it's more of an enterprise scenario. And this is how it looks like. I simplify the profile. And this is in simulator, this is how it looks like. Okay? What you can see here, every line here is a flow. Okay, so you can see that the flows, many colors here, every color is a different profile. But there are the connection per second for everyone is the same. But now you can see flows that the inter-packet gap is different. For example, this is RTP. There is a talkie, so you see the back-to-back here. And I took really a microsecond, 10 microseconds of the profile and stopped that. But I didn't stop the flows. So if this is how it looks like. If you will zoom into a real scenario, you see that it's really complex. And every time, everything run in real time with really complex scheduler. The key in the software is the scheduler, but I won't talk about the design of the software here. Okay. This is how we solve a NAT and firewall case. So again, in our case, we can test only features that inspect the traffic, doesn't change the traffic. For example, if you have a firewall that terminate TCP, TRex won't help you. But if most of the feature in our case only inspect the traffic and change specific field in the packet. For example, in case of firewall and NAT, there is a feature of randomization. Anyone familiar with seen randomization attack? And in case of NAT, there is the in-out translation. And this is what we do. We learn the translation and we learn the new scene. Once we learn everything, we can play the new scene again. And the system, the important thing is that the dude will think that this is a realistic scenario and will react to that. And this is what we achieve. And we achieve it in really high scale. So in high scale of flows, clients, and servers, etc. So this is what we do. I will show in the demo, you will see the errors that we seen is this one. Night timeout means that the NAT dropped the packet because it couldn't handle the new flows. No feed, it means that we couldn't achieve a feed. There is a lot of type of errors that you can see. There is a new feature that actually we created to scale the number of clients, but not the bandwidth. It's important for a controller. For example, if you have controller and you want to control a lot of DUT, in our case, 5,000 control DUT, okay, and you want to see the bandwidth that in one path there is specific bandwidth, in another specific different bandwidth, and want to see that the controller see all the traffic. This is what we did. We could specify for every client what would be the path. Okay, for example, for specific client, we can say, hey, your default gateway is here, and then you got back from here, and you get, and the returning, it's a different VLAN or different GRE. By the way, there is a, if you look in our blog, there is a company, Vazona, I think, that are using something like that to test LTE, and they post it. And they say, hey, thank you guys for the great tool. Okay? But this is the use case. I think that Rackspace is using this feature too. This is the example. You can give for each client a path, a VLAN in one direction, a default gateway in one direction, and a different VLAN in another direction. And by that, you can create a lot of scenarios that all the traffic goes from, let's say, this VLAN and return from another VLAN and see if the controller react. Okay, this is the flow order. There is another thing, because we have the ability to add metadata to the packet and test the order, that the dude didn't change the order of the packets. For example, if you have RTP and the dude and device under test change the order of the packet, we will know that. And this is the performance. You can see that we improve lately the performance. What you can see here, before that, what you can see that the scale of the number, this is the number of active flow, the concurrent flow, once you have a lot of concurrent flow, for example, in Linux, I think it will break in a really low number. You can see that I play with 8 million flows easily, and it can be more. I wanted to, and we changed the algorithm. You can see that this line is the new one. You can have 5 million packets per second for one core with 8 million flows. 5 mega packet per second for one core. So if you have 10 core, you can get, this is extrapolation, you can get to about 400 gig. If you have the right NIC and number of cores, you can get to 400 gig for realistic traffic with one UCS that costs like 5K for you, 3K for us. Okay. Let me show an example before I get to the stateless. I will get into, exit from that. By the way, there is two options to to play with T-Rex. You can take a virtual box. This is a virtual box on my machine. Okay, you can see I can play with it, and I can give a profile, like the DNS that I showed you. The duration, I want to test latency, and the multiplier, let's say 10. This is the latest version, and you can see that because it's my virtual box, you see the latency, it's really big. There is a lot of jitter. It's 50 milliseconds. Okay, but I get all the packets that I'm sending. This is the number of client, 400. Active flow is 1 or 0 because it's really low speed. And this is the latency. Let me test it. Let me show you this demo on a real hardware. And I managed to VPN to my... okay. This is really high-end router. It's ESP200, if you know, ASR1K, the high-speed services router. This is a script that I'm looking for the CPU utilization of the router. Okay, it's zero now, there is no traffic. And let me run, let me run a profile. Oh, something happened here. Okay. This is the profile that we that I showed you, the SFR profile, which is realistic, a lot of scenario. Let me try it with 25 gig. Latency of 100K packet per second. And the multiplier 25 and minus D, and I want to test. And let's try to learn a translation too. What happened? You can see here in the bottom the latency from each port. You see that the traffic is not symmetrical. This is something that is usual happen. In one direction is 2 gig, and the other from the server to the client there is more traffic. This is usual, right? There is more download than upload. So here you see 8 gig, and this is 3 gig. The total is 25. Okay, there is latency from each port. You can see that the port that have more traffic, there is more latency. The maximum is 135, jitter is higher. And the number of flows you can see here, the active flows. In this case, it's relatively low. It's 100K concurrent flow for 25 gig. Let's see what happened with the router. The router is doing only routing right now. It's it's nothing for him, right, to do routing. It's 12% CPU utilization. And we can connect to the to all the statistics. All the statistics are published. And everyone can write a program to see it in a different way. I wrote a simple program, you know, to see the all the information in live. And you can see the latency here from server and client. It's different. And the histogram is 100, which is good. Everything works fine. Now let's change a bit. Let me show you something interesting. Now let me enable NAT, okay? By the way, I'm using an old version because I wanted to show the demo. Those guys, by the way, back then told me that we don't want to break your demo, so we cannot fix the bug. But I think in the new version, it was fixed. And right now I'm enabling NAT. You see the inside and outside. And I will use a simplified version of the profile. And I will add a check and learn. These two switch, what I'm telling to the router, to the T-Rex, please learn the translation, the first packet of the flow, see what the router did for them, and learn and react to those packets. Not just replay. It's a smart replay that I've showed you. Okay? There is NAT. Now let's see what happened. You will see that the latency is much higher. It's good until now. You see that we started with issues. You see, many flows didn't open. The router dropped them. Again, this is ESP200. It should support 200 gig, and it supports 200 gig. But the problem is that they didn't test it with a realistic scenario back then. Okay, so there is a lot of issues. So now imagine that you are a customer. You won't even see this issue because you start a HTTP browsing, it drops, it will try again, and then everything is okay. But we can figure it out in the lab in scale. Now see the latency here. You remember it was 100 microseconds, now it's 1 millisecond. And if we wait a bit more, you will see that there are spikes. You see this spike here of the latency? You see this, that the histogram now is going to 2.7 milliseconds in latency. This is not something normal. And it's relatively low speed. It's only 25 gig. So you see the importance of quality and testing it in the lab, not in production, right? You can give your customer to test it for you. Okay, you see the spike see the spike of latency? By the way, the latency here is everything. It's not just the packet that you send. Is the I'm sending the latency packet on the port on EF packets. It means that it check end to end if the lowest latency. This is the lowest latency packet that you can get. And you see now there is spike of 1 second now. It's broke. Okay, again, I'm using very old version only for the demo, just to present to you what happened 2-3 years ago. Don't test it in your lab with the ASR. Okay, I think we finished this demo. This is, you know, just a glimpse of what you can do with it. You can play with the template. There are companies, by the way, that creating script, test script that create the YAML file, and the YAML could get to really high. They send me something 1 megabyte of YAML file that the script generated for them, and they are doing automatic test. And there is a Python API to automate everything. Okay. Back to the presentation. This was a stateful. Now I'm getting to a different world, which is called stateless. And again, everything can be done from your laptop. Now, you can install it in 5 minutes and you can see everything. So the story about stateless, how we come from stateful to stateless, what is, why? So what happened is that the T-Rex spread for a few group in Cisco. It was really effective. And we started to open it and show it in DPDK Summit and so on. And we applied to Pioneer One and we won. After we won, there was, you know, a track in Cisco to create traffic generator, and T-Rex was chosen as the next generation traffic generator, and there was a lot of traction, and we got resource. My manager here, Lior, managed that. Lior, raise your hand. Okay, so, and when we went to the team to ask, what do you need? What do you need? So, what do you think they told us? Almost everything. Everything that Ixia Inspire does, GUI, all the protocol, everything. But we were a small team of two people. But what I learned, by the way, from this discussion with a lot of team, that stateful is a niche. Is a niche for a specific feature. You cannot test everything. If you want, you know, like Pareto principle, you want to get from the 20% that get the 80% value, right? And what we and stateless is this, okay? It's the thing that we could do, the 20% feature that we could do to give 80% of the value, 80% of the use cases. We cannot do 100% of the use case, okay? And there was a lot of there is a lot of users that use stateless today in the open source in VPP, if you know VPP FDIO for testing. And in one liner, what stateless means is to do RFC 2544 and to test feature like that in easy way. Okay, so it's like in Ixia, it has much higher scale than stateful because there is no context of flow, no context of packet, no context of clients. So it really can get to even 30 mega packet per second per one core related to five. It can get all the interfaces that they add. It can get 140 Mellanox Intel. It support profiles. I will show what is a profile. And there is a TUI and GUI. I will show it in the demo. Statistic per port, statistic per stream. This is really important. If you create a stream, you want to get statistic on this stream. So if you have two streams, one will hit the quality of service and another one not. You want to see the statistic of this stream versus the other stream, right? And there is a Python API. We support both 3 and .7. It was a painful, but we did that. And the reason is that Cisco is using PyATS infrastructure, which is Python. But there are companies that I'm aware of that are I took the Java backend of the GUI and uses that as a Java. We don't have other language API yet. But I will show you the design, and you will see that it's not a big deal. Before that, the design principle here that you have a profile of traffic. You define what is the profile, exactly like stateful, but the definition is different. Once you define a profile, you can take it through the GUI, through the TUI, through the API, whatever, and you say you can amplify it. You can say, hey, put me in 10 megapacket per second, 200 gig, 10% of the port, whatever. We will do it for you. And this is an example of profile. This is Swift stream, this is a continuous stream, this is a burst of three packet, and in the definition there is something that you can say, hey, initiate a new stream. Don't start this stream at the start. Another stream will initiate that. And you can define every property of that, and I will show example. So once you define a profile through all the combinations you have, you can start, stop, get statistic per stream, per. And it's very easy to write a test using that. It's very flexible. Okay, this is the high-level design. There is a separation, not like the stateful. There is a separation between the server and the client. And let's start from the client. In the client, you have three types of user. One is the CLI, the console that I will show in the demo. One is the API. One is HLT. Please raise your hand. Who is using HLT today? No one? No one. Okay. And there is a GUI. The GUI is going through a the same core module here, and everything is talking through a zero-MQ infrastructure, which is blazingly fast over JSON. So you can read this command and understand what's happening. This was really easy for us to develop the GUI and the TUI and the API. And the servers take that, compile everything, and move it to the data plane. Okay, this is the architecture. So you can have a lot of type of client, different type of client, web client. You can see, by the way, here a few use cases of TRex. Okay, there is an NFV benchmark in one of the that shows a use case of automation. They replaced, they are using this module to create another layer of automation with web to test NFV. Okay. It could be multi-user. One user can acquire these two ports and another two ports, and two users can use different type of, one can use API, another one can use GUI. This is the relation, this is important. There is port, everything is per port. It's not like the stateful that there's a combination of two port, client and server. Everything is per port, and there is traffic profile that I've showed. Every profile has stream, it can have multiple stream, and as each stream has packet template, how to transmit it, continuous, burst, multi-burst, and so on, which field to change in the packet, and what is the statistic you need to gather. Really simple. Simple model, simple design. And this is the hello world. This is really the essence of the profile. And this profile defined two, one stream per port. And let's see. The source IP is 16.0.0.1 to 48.0.0.1. You can see here that we are using SCAPI. How many of you using SCAPI? No SCAPI? Please raise your hand. Great. It's great, right? It's really simple. You see this. You see how simple it is. It's just one liner to define a packet. If you want to define VXLAN or something, just put VXLAN, NSH. Whatever protocol, you can define new protocol, multicast, unicast, whatever. Define the packet, put the mode here, everything is default. There is a lot of properties that you can change, but the default will work for you. And in this case, there will be one stream of one packet without changing any field in continuous. And it will be different in port zero. Port zero will have direction zero, and port one will have direction one. So this will be the swapping of the direction. Really simple, right? We intend to do it really simple for dev test, and the complexity is inside the code. Let's see more complex scenario. Let's say you want to have three streams in different speed and in different in the packet gap. The same trick. You define an array of streams. The only difference is the PPS, packet per second. This is 10, this is 20, this is 40. And the packet is different because the source IP is different. So you see it's really, this is another simple example. It's a burst that initiate multi-burst. Let's see how we do this. This is new here, right? The initiation of one to another. So we can give a name. We can say, hey, you are S1, and the next is you are S0, and the next is S1, and you are S1. And we will match this next. Once you will run it, only this will run. Once it finishes, you will initiate this one. And you can see the difference here. This is the multi-burst, and this is a single burst. This is the new mode. So in single mode, we can say how many packets we have. And here, we can say how many bursts we have and how many packets per each burst. So you can look into the tutorial. It's really simple to understand. It's just object in Python that you can build. And there is a ton of examples. Now, this is another thing is, let's see how long, how much. OK, I have 5 minutes, so I will hurry up. This is a way to change field in the packet. For example, I want to create random packet size. I want to change the toss. I want to change client size. I want to the nice thing about that is that you can change any field, including field of protocol that doesn't exist today. Okay, because you can define them using SCAPI, and you can define them using this methodology. I will skip that. This is an example of changing to create scene attack. Okay, what I'm doing here, I'm defining a scene here. I'm defining a scene, and I put this program in Python to change the scene. What I want to do is to create many type of source, many type of source port to single destination, 48001. So I'm defining a variable here, I'm defining a variable here, and this is the key here, this one, to where to write it. See what I'm writing, I'm to write it to ip.source. I'm writing it in the convention of SCAPI. So if I have a new header with a new field, I can write to any field I like. So I write it to the source, and I write to the port, and that's it. I have a scene attack. And blazingly fast, you will see, it can compile, load, and run. OK, we'll skip that. This is another feature that we can take a pickup file, convert it to streams, like in Ixia, import pickup file, convert it to stream. Every stream is a burst of one packet and point to another stream. There is another thing that is, we are using it. If you have a terabyte of traffic, you can convert it to a, I will skip that. This is the per stream statistic. Let's skip that. Latency, service mode. Service mode is something really, really, really new and important. Usually in traffic, you have a lot of emulation, right? You have to emulate IPv6, you want to do scan, you want to do ARP, you want to do multicast or whatever. And what we did, we have a mode in service mode that you can handle the packet here and get everything to the Python. So you can write your state machine in Python in slow mode, prepare everything, stop the service mode, and then bump the traffic on the multicast. For example, you can create a lot of multicast in SCAPI, really simple, and then create a test. So you see the power of that? We created a lot of infrastructure like scan 6, scan the network in IPv6, prepare ARP, traffic capturing working in this mode too. You can capture traffic in high rate, relatively high rate. Functional tests can run on that, a new protocol. This is an example of capturing. You can capture a port. You can say, hey, capture this port and redirect it to Wireshark. And then you can see all the packet in Wireshark. Again, it doesn't work with 160 megapackets per second, but at least you can debug the sessions. The performance, as I said, this is a setup that we have. It's like, this is for one core. See, it's around 35 megapackets per second for one core. You can saturate 40 gig port in one core. Okay? With a small packet. Automation. So until now, I talked about profile. How to define a profile, how to... But how do I do control over the profile? How do I start the traffic? How do I get statistic? So this is a different type of API, and this is an example. I can connect, reset, add the profile here, and then do the start on specific port and specific rate and specific duration, and then I can wait, or either I can gather the statistic in the middle, and then I can disconnect. This is, there is a lot of example in the code, but this is the high level. You take a profile, you start it, you add it, you start, you wait, and you gather the statistics. That's it. And the API is the same for all the profile. So you have the profile and the what to do with the profile. And this is the automation. This is how it looks like. Before I, I have 1 minute, so let's do. The time is now is important. I couldn't remove that. And let me show you a new, really, the Mellanox support is already there. You can take 100 gig, connect 5, and connect 4. And this is something new, that there is an initiative to take this logic to utilize all the logic that we have here and just replace that with FPGA. And then you can get to 400 gig, multiple 400 gig NIC on the same port. And we have 30 seconds of demo. Let me show it on my laptop. So see what I'm doing here, I'm in interactive mode. Okay, this is the server, and then I can connect with the GUI. I won't show the console yet. So you can have a GUI here. I can acquire port. I can start, I think, take a profile. The nice thing about that, I can go to advanced mode, for example. And then, you see in advanced mode, you can build any packet you like, because this is copy. You can build here, add layer, remove layer, change field, change the field engine. You have the full flexibility here. You can back to a simple mode. This is like Osinato. It's really simplify things to build, but you cannot control any aspect. In the advanced mode, you can control anything. You can build new layers, new headers, everything. And then once I've saved it, I can add more and more profile. I can update it, start it, and see statistics. It's not full feature yet, the GUI, but it's give 50% of the functionality, but they are working. Maybe in a few months, it will be full functional with the server functionality. And then I can, you know, I can change this. Probably I will kill my battery if I do that, because it's run on my server. You can see here, see the CPU is going up because I'm killing my laptop. This is the server side, and this is the client side. Now they are the same. You see that the 66K peak packet per second is taking 33% of my CPU. And I think that's it. I can add more stream, I can stop, start. And the nice thing about it's the API that you can do everything. That's it. Thank you.